chapter 13 verse 12. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness and let us put on the armor of light. For the last 2 weeks, we are meditating on the armor of light or the weapons of light. In chapter 12, we are able to see about 30 points. See, what are the armors or what are the weapons of light or what is the armor of light? Because of the renewing of our mind, we should have changed in our appearance. We must think soberly. We must love others with no pretension. We should abhor evil. And when we know something is good, we should cleave to good. When we love others, we should love others as our own family members. In honoring others, we should outdo others. And we should not be indolent. We should do everything with a lot of enthusiasm and speed. The weapon of light, we should not feel shy, or we should avoid doing an extra work. We should not avoid in straining ourselves. And what is the other weapons of light? We should be very enthusiastic in our spirit. We should be slave to the Lord. And also we studied the only joy is our hope. It's not just what we are doing, what others praise us, and what is our hope, what is our goal. That should be our joy. When there is adverse situations, we should be patient and we should never give up prayer. We should take care of the saints in all their necessities, and showing hospitality or entertaining strangers, we should perceive that. We should always bless others, we should not curse them, and we should rejoice with them that rejoice and weep with them that weep. And also we consider we must know how to live in harmony with others and seek not very high things for us. We should know how to be happy and content with what we have. And we must be, this is what the Bible teaches, we must be able to mix with ordinary or common people. And don't think that you are very wise in your own sight, in your own estimate, and not evil for evil. Consider in advance to be honorable. What is the best thing that you can do that you could be found honorable in the sight of others? And three more, or four more, do best to live at peace with everyone. And it's not right with you to execute punishment on others. Don't avenge others. There is a magistrate, magistrate of the magistrates, judge of the judges, king of the kings. He will avenge. So give space for him to work. Allow God to work. You don't rob that space. Don't narrow down the space and you execute judgment. Allow God to work and overcome evil with good. We are able to see 30 points. And from chapter 13, there we read about the weapons of light. This morning I love to share with you 10 points. Number 1, verses 1, 2 and 3. Let every soul, that is every person, every aadmi, be subject unto the higher powers. I told you many times that when I was a young boy, maybe in standard 3 or 4, I remember my father taught me many proverbs, many maxims. And one of the maxims my father taught me, obey your immediate superior. That's the rule in the military. Obey your immediate superior. And 2 days back, I was sharing this with one servant of God. Obedience, by the grace of God, it was a nature for me from my childhood. Obedience to my parents, obedience to my teachers, obedience to my elders, obedience to my annan, my akamar. And when I started working, obedience to my heads of the institution, that was very natural for me, obedience to my pastors. I praise God for the nature He has given me. So here it says, subject unto the higher powers, subject unto the authorities, maybe a team leader, maybe a manager, maybe a boss. So you must have a grace to obey them, obey your parents, obey elders, obey your husband, obey the rules of the land. Subject unto the higher powers, for there is no power but of God. So somebody is powerful over you. There is a principal. There is a team leader. He has got some authority. Whatever that power, it is from God. God has made him the team leader. God has made him your husband. God has made him your elder brother. God has made him your mother. God has given you. So when you obey the authority, you obey God. You obey God's authority. When you don't obey your higher authorities, you don't obey God. When you don't obey pastor, it doesn't mean that you don't obey pastor. You are not obeying God who has given you as the pastor. When you don't obey a police or a signal, it's not that you are breaking a signal, you are breaking a rule that God has given. My dear brother, my dear sister, here it says, for there is no power but of God. The powers that be are ordained of God. Whosoever therefore resisteth the power, they resisteth the ordinance of God. He said, no, I don't want to obey my husband. You are resisting the ordinance of God. No, I don't obey my father. You are resisting the ordinance of God. You are resisting the ordinance of God, the Bible says. So the weapon of light is the obedience to higher powers. They got an energy. They can arrest you. They can punish you. They got a power. They are principalities. As we say, municipalities, local body, prince. And principality is the rule the prince has got. Municipality, the rule the municipality has got. Mayor, he has got a rule. So when you resist that rule, you are resisting God. And they that resist shall receive to themselves damnation. When you resist an authority, you are resisting God, and they that resist God shall receive damnation. How so-and-so has become your father? It's not your choice. You are born in that family. You are born in that family. In the place of the father, he gives a rule. You must come at 6 o'clock. Who gives the rule? The father. Who has made him your father? The Lord has made him your father. Your father gives a rule, come at 6 o'clock. And you resisted, no, Dad, it's not possible. No, I won't do it. You are resisting that rule. You are not resisting that man. You are resisting God who has ordained him your father. So they that resist God will receive damnation. They call their mothers, you don't know anything. They call their fathers, be quiet, daddy. They receive of God damnation. Damnation. It's not a question, who is your father, who is your mother? But do you resist authorities? My dear brother, my dear sister, for rulers are not terror to good works, but to the evil. In general, but in Christ, we are called to obey. Will thou then not be afraid? Will thou then not be afraid of the power? They got power. Power and principality, they go together. They got an authority. Why do you want to resist that authority? You invite damnation. So the weapon of light, submit to authorities. Submit to authorities. If they say come at 8 o'clock, try to go at 8 o'clock. If they say come at 9 o'clock, try to go at 9 o'clock. Love to obey is an honor. It's a weapon of light. With all humility, I tell you, I got the right to speak on that. I got a right to speak on that. I love to obey. Obey the rules. Obey the signal. Just I tell you one incident, there are a number of incidents I can say. One incident I tell you. For one exhibition in our school, the principal requested me to do some work, very urgent work. I was doing that overnight. I started around 10 o'clock. I had two or three boys with me. Around 5 o'clock, the principal came. Simon, didn't you sleep at all? No, sir, I'll finish it. By 6 o'clock, I finished the work. I rushed to my house. Our house was nearby. I had enough time only to wash myself, to bath, dressed up. I don't remember even I had my breakfast. I must have had some beverage. 8:15, the teachers must be there. I went there around 8:20. You know what my principal told me? I still remember he was holding his hands at the back. Even he was not looking at my face, looking into a different direction. Still I remember that scene. He told me, Simon, I know that you are working all through the night. Other teachers may not know. That's all he said. You are coming late, 5 minutes late. You are coming late. Other teachers may not know that you are late. May not know that you worked all through the night. What other teachers will know? They know that you are only late. That's what he said. I know that you are working all through the night. Others may not know that. Others may not know that. My dear brother, my dear sister, if my memory goes right, if I am wrong, the Lord should forgive me. I was not hurt. I was not hurt. I took it as a pride. And I couldn't say, in my records, there was not one day I was late. Submit to authorities. Don't reason out. Don't reason out. It is the weapon of light. It is the weapon of light. My dear brother, my dear sister. Where this is in your studies, in your church, in all the other programs. Have this weapon of light. Never be late. 1 minute late. 2 minutes late. There's nothing like that. You miss the flight by 5 minutes, you miss the flight. You miss the flight by 2 days, 2 hours, you miss the flight. Late by 1 minute or late by 5 minutes, late by 10 minutes, the same effect. Late is late. It's all our mindset. It's all our mindset. My dear brother, my dear sister. I know in one company, their login time is 8 o'clock. 7:59, that system will not open. 7:59, the system will not open. 8:01, it will show that you are late by 1 minute. 7:59, you cannot open the system. If you open it 8:01, it will show that you are 1 minute late. My dear brother, my dear sister, take a joy in obeying the authorities. Glory be to the Lord's holy name. And weapon number 32, I call that weapon number 31. And we'll go to weapon number 32 if you are numbering them. Do that which is good. Earlier we saw one point, cleave to good. Now Paul says in verse 3, the latter part, do that which is good, and thou shalt have praise of the same. What is good? You try to do that. All these points are interconnected. You may have to strain yourself to do an extra work. You may have to strain yourself to do an extra work. But do that which is good, and thou shalt have praise of the same. For that good work, you shall have a praise. Whether the people of the world will appreciate or not, heaven will appreciate. Well done, my good and faithful servant. Well done, my good and faithful servant. Heaven will appreciate. My dear brother, my dear sister, do that good work. Your good work is very, very essential. So here we read verse 4, for he is the minister of God to thee for good. But if thou do that which is evil, be afraid. For he beareth not the sword in vain. Do good. Be happy about it. Say, a child goes to her class in time or before time. Will she be afraid of the teacher? Very cheerfully, she'll say, good morning, miss. Vanakkam, teacher. Vanakkam, ma. Vanakkam, ya. Good morning, sir. She would love to be seen by the headmaster. She's there before time. The headmaster was passing by. She'll say, sir, good morning, sir. Good morning, sir. That headmaster will look at the, oh, good morning, because that girl is in time. That boy is in time. Oh, good morning. Well. There will be an appreciation. Just imagine the child is late by 1 minute. The gate is closed. The gate is closed for those who are 1 minute late and those who are 10 minutes late. All are standing out. The child may not be happy to see the teacher. The child will be afraid of the teacher. The child will be afraid of the headmaster. The child will be afraid of the punishment. Whenever you do something wrong, you have to be afraid of somebody. Whenever you do something good, you love to see those people. You need not say, sorry, sir. There will be no need to say sorry. Because you have done what is right. You need not feel sorry for what you have done. So here it is very clearly said. But if thou do that, for he is a minister of God to thee for good. But if thou do that which is evil, be afraid. You have done your homework. You have completed your homework. Will you be afraid? Your boss has given an assignment. You have completed that assignment. Will you be afraid? The company has fixed a target. You achieved the target. Will you be afraid? Will you be afraid of anybody? This is the strength of the children of God. This is the weapon of light. I'm not teaching you religion. I'm not just saying God will prosper you. But day-to-day practical life, I tell you. Day-to-day practical life, I tell you. Weapon of light. Do that is good. That's your strength. You need not be afraid of anybody. You can always have a head high. It doesn't mean that you are proud. But you need not be afraid of any authority. If you don't have a license, you are driving the vehicle, you see a policeman, you'll be afraid. You don't have a license. You have got license. You need not be afraid of him. You need not be afraid of him. He that is doing good will not be afraid of anybody. My dear brother, my dear sister, only those who are doing wrong things are those who make mistakes. They should be afraid of the power. So number one, submit to authorities. Number two, or I can say 31, 32. Do that is good. Do that is good. And 33, render all dues. From verse 5 we read, wherefore you must needs be subject, not only for wrath, but also for conscience sake. You should not obey others only because you don't want to be punished. Not for wrath's sake, but for conscience sake. For this cause, pay tribute also, for they are God's ministers, attending continually upon this very thing. Render therefore to all their dues, tribute to whom tribute is due, custom to whom custom, fear to whom fear, honor to whom honor. Woe no man anything. Today the third weapon of light, point number 33. What you have to pay others, you pay others. Don't be in due. What you have to pay to your parents, pay to them. What you have to pay to your children, you pay to them. If you have to pay your rent, you pay your rent. My dear brother, my dear sister, be honest. You have to pay tax, pay tax. Don't try to evade tax. Don't try to see how you can evade from the tax. Take a decision, how you can pay tax to the government. Be proud that you are a taxpayer. That's a wonderful thing. That's a weapon of light. Be proud to be a taxpayer. And don't try to find out what's the best route to avoid toll. Don't try to find out a toll-free route and get your tire punctured. Be proud that you pay the toll. Be proud that you pay the tribute. And when you buy a vehicle, be proud that you pay the EMI. What is you have to pay to others, you pay it. When you are staying in a house, be proud to pay the rent. Be proud to pay the rent. My dear brother, my dear sister, I'm afraid that when I'm taking these points, I cannot but say a few things from my lifestyle. A couple of weeks back, the landlord, the house owner of the house where we are staying, he was sending a message to me, a very happy message. Yesterday, another house owner was talking to me. They are lovers. When we are vacating one house, the lady of the house said, the fort around us is falling. The fort around us is falling. Even the time when there was a death in the family, that meant the rent was not delayed. Marriage in our family, the rent was not delayed. We cannot imagine one day where there's a quarrel. Another house, when we said that we were vacating, we understood later, 3 days the lady of the house could not, she didn't eat properly, knowing that we are vacating. Why I say this? Whatever you have to pay to others, you pay to them. Only when you finish your dues. Nowadays at times, I forget, I don't justify that, I feel very bad about it. I forget to pay my phone bills, etc. Only when the reminder comes and immediately, hurriedly I pay. Till this day, there's no due. Why I say this? After you finish your dues, you got the right to take your coffee. You can take your coffee, you can spend for your coffee only when you make sure that you have paid other dues. When you don't have, you haven't paid others' dues, we don't have a moral right to meet our needs. Well, what you have to pay to your father, you pay to your father. What you have to pay to your child, you pay to your child. Then you sip your coffee. You don't pay the fees for the school child. She has to go and stand out. And you are enjoying biryani. Absolute nonsense, ridiculous. Absolute nonsense, ridiculous. What you have to pay for the child, you have to pay for the child. The child is facing the problem in the school. What is the weapon of light? What you have to pay for, others pay first. Pay first. You can't have a big credit that I got that much of dues. Avoiding taking the phones. What is the weapon of light? What you have to pay, you pay. The Bible teaches. The Bible teaches. It's an honorable thing. I love the Carmelites follow this. They all are golden rules. I believe these 40 points are golden rules. So render all dues. So forever, therefore, to all their dues. Tribute to whom tribute is due. Custom to whom custom due. Fear to whom fear is due. Honor to whom honor is due. Owe no man anything. Owe no man anything. That's a beautiful Christian principle. My dear brother, my dear sister. 34. The fourth point for this day. Owe no man anything, but to love one another. For he that loveth another hath fulfilled the law. For this, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not bear false witness, thou shalt not covet, and if there be any other commandment, it is briefly comprehended in this saying, namely, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. So the 34th point, love your neighbor. That is the fulfillment of all the commandments, whatever the commandment may be. When you love your neighbor, you will not kill him. When you love your neighbor, you will not go to his wife. You will not lust her husband. You are loving your neighbor. You love your neighbor, you will not speak bad about him. You will not bear a false witness to him. You are loving him. You will not rob him. You will not rob his money, rob his name, rob his fame. You will not rob him. So when you love others, love your neighbor, in whatever the form, it can be comprehended, it can be understood comprehensively, that you are fulfilling God's all commandments. All the 10 commandments can be brought into two broader headings: love God, love neighbor. Love God, love neighbor. Who is my neighbor? That great scholar asked our Savior, who is my neighbor? Because it was a very big discussion. Who is my neighbor? Who is my neighbor? Just for understanding, for Sister Abby, Lydia is the neighbor sitting next to her. So it said in the Old Testament, love your neighbor. So Abby loves Lydia. Now the question comes, is Jenny her neighbor? Is Noella her neighbor? They are not next to Abi. Should Abi love them? Because the Bible says, love your neighbor. Who is my neighbor? Who is my neighbor? So many people are unable to answer that question. So it was predominantly a big talk about the scholars to define my neighbor. Many times we may not be able to define the terms. There was a discussion among scholars that somebody said we can define all words. Somebody said, no, we can't define all words. So the heated argument was going on. And somebody who believed that they can define all words, believe who cannot define all words, he asked a question, can you define a dog? A dog, how to define a dog? A dog that walks with four legs. All animals walk with four legs. A dog has got 2 ears. All animals have got 2 ears. So they are trying to define what a dog is. So immediately one man had a bright idea and said, dog box! Dog box! Man from the other side said, my wife does. So it's not that easy to define everything. Who is my neighbor? So according to the law, Abby's neighbor is Lydia. She loves Lydia. Now according to the law, she is not bound to love others. They are not her neighbors. They are not sitting next to her. So who is my neighbor? It's a great philosophical question among the scholars. So this scholar knew very well that he can trap Jesus in his argument. Jesus will be lost for answer. So he asked that $1 million question. Hey, tell me who my neighbor is. The Bible says, love your neighbor as thyself. Who my neighbor is? That's the reason Jesus told him the Good Samaritan story. And Jesus at the end said, don't ask a question, who is your neighbor? When somebody is suffering, be his neighbor. Don't ask a question, who is my neighbor? When somebody is suffering, be his neighbor. Be his neighbor. It's not in the church, it's not on the chairs. When there's a small problem for a Jenny, Abby goes to her. Abby becomes the neighbor of Jenny. There's the problem for another person, maybe Leon. Abby goes to Leon. Abby becomes the neighbor of Leon. What does it actually mean? Be close to somebody who is in trouble. Don't be that Pharisee. Don't be the priest, the Levite, turning your face and walking out when somebody is in trouble. The greatest love you can exhibit to be with somebody when they are in trouble. When they are in the prison, be with them. When they are walking in the wilderness, be with them. When they are crossing the rivers, be with them. When they are in the fire, be with them. That's our God. That's the God we are worshipping. Our God. Why do I worship Him? Not because He could deliver them from the fire. I worship Him because He can be with them in the fire. Delivering them from fire will show His strength, His might, His prowess, His magic power, His supernatural power, delivering them from the fire. But only walking with them in the fire can reveal His love. Providing manna is His power, but walking in with them in the wilderness is His love. My dear brother, my dear sister, love your neighbor. Here literally means that just love anybody next to your house, be in the street, in a school. No, not like that. Literally, do something to somebody who is suffering. Before we could continue, allow that, put your left hand on your chest. We prayed for our nation. Slip your right hand towards the heaven. Just say one prayer. Lord, give me grace to be next to somebody who is suffering. Just pray. That is loving your neighbor. Lord, give me grace to be close to somebody who suffers. That's really loving somebody. Give me grace that I should be the neighbor of somebody who is on the Jericho. That's Christianity. That is the weapon of light. It's not loving, loving, loving. Undoing love. God bless you. That's what the Bible says. Love your neighbor. Verse 10. Love worker no ill to the neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. Love is the fulfilling of the law. What is this love? Doing love. What is this doing love? Be close to somebody who is in need. That love indeed. 35, the fifth point for this day. Very, very essential. I don't say other points are less essential, but this point is very essential. Verse 11, and that knowing the time, that now is the high time to awake out of sleep, for now is our salvation nearer than when we believed. Know the time. Know the time, the day that we are living in. We must know the time. What type of a time we are living in. The situation around us. Our salvation is nearer than when we saved, when we were saved. I got saved in the year 1972. Now my salvation is nearer than it was in 1972. You got saved in 2000. Now your salvation is nearer by 16 years than when you got saved. You are saved only last year. Now your salvation is nearer at least by 1 year than when you got saved. We are living in the midst of crooked and perverse generation. We have to be very careful that in what type of days we are living in. What type of days we are living in. We should know the time. We cannot allow the time to slip through our fingers. In Ephesians 5:16, redeem the time because the days are evil. Because the days are evil. My dear brother, my dear sister, I know one father. Once he asked his children, his son and daughter, he asked his children, have you ever seen Appa chumma irukanga? Have you ever seen Appa chumma? Both of them said, they have never seen their father chumma. Chumma irukiren. There was a jokeless story. Three men went to heaven. American, one Japanese, and one of our people. So the pearl gate, the angel asked American, why did you come to, why do you want to come to heaven? Said, I heard that Jesus is in heaven. I heard that saints are in heaven. So I want to see all those people. I want to see Jesus. I want to see the saints. And I know that my parents are in heaven. I want to see them. That's why I want to go to heaven. He said, okay, wait. He called the Japanese and asked, where do you want to go to heaven? The Japanese said, We are just employed all the techniques on the earth, the inventions. I want to learn something new from heaven. Is there any new invention? How God operates, how the angels operate. I want to find out a new invention. That's why I come to heaven. He said, okay, you wait. Then third, our person went. He said, why did he come to heaven? He thought for a while. He said, why did that American come to heaven? He came to see Jesus and the saints. Why did you come want to go to heaven? Why did this fellow, Japan fellow, came to heaven? Hey, he want to learn some new techniques. That's why he has come to heaven. Why do you want to go to heaven? Don't bother about them. Why you want to go to heaven? He thought for some more time. He came out with the answer and said, chumma. Yeah, Allah, the one chumma. You ask somebody, some friend may come. Yeah, vandinga chumma vandinga. You meet somebody on the street, why are you standing here? Chumma nikre. And the worst thing, really ridiculous. I see some group of people standing and talking. What are you talking? Chumma basit. Whatever they do, chumma. They live chumma. They eat chumma. My dear, I tell you very honestly, know the time. A minute that wasted, you can never trace it back. You can never trace it back. A minute that you wasted. A minute that is wasted. You cannot trace it back. You should not be chumma. We have got very short time. You have saved for some 2 years, 10 years. You have not saved one soul. Suppose you die today. How will you meet God without one soul with which to greet Him? How will you face God? You achieve this glorious salvation. In your record, you don't have one soul with which to meet God. Don't go to God empty-handed. What that you can take to God? That's a fruit. Ministry is a fruit. Can you imagine that you'll meet God empty-handed? Knowing the time, redeem the time. Today some evil is taking place. Husband is going to work, wife is going to work, they're working in different shifts. They don't have time to meet at all. They don't have time to meet at all. When he comes, she sleeps. When she comes, he sleeps. At times they have to find other avenues to satisfy their natural urges. It's evil. And both go to work. Then only we can bring up our children. Then only we can give all the luxuries to our children. We work for our children. You say that you work for your children and finally you lose your child. You lose your child. You lose values. You can earn money, but you may not have a purpose for what you are earning money. For what you are earning money. We don't know how to redeem time. We don't know how to set our priorities. The weapon of light, you must know the time. The time you are living in. The time that is in your hand. How to utilize the time carefully. How to invest the time. If you sow the time, you'll reap the time. What's the spiritual technique to redeem time? My dear brother, my dear sister, it's very, very important. The weapon number 5, knowing the time. Weapon number 6, 36, point number. Walk not in rioting and drunkenness. What is rioting? Rioting, in one translation it says, don't go to in contemporary English version. Contemporary English version. Don't go to wild parties. There's laughing, jumping, revelry. There's nothing good. Just a picnic. Just an outing. Don't go to wild parties. English Standard Version says, not in orgies, in bracket, a wild party characterized by excessive drinking and indiscriminate sex activities. Indiscriminate sex activities. These sex activities will be in different forms. In different forms. They go for a picnic as few families. It is not sex activities, it is always not sharing the bed, not intercourse, not seeing the nakedness of the other person. The sex activity is seen, it's overt in so many different ways. In so many different ways. Say two husbands and wife, they go for a party. They just play a carom game. They just play a carom game. They feel it was a very forward thinking, very progressive people. They put a team. This man and another man's wife. And his wife will be teaming with another person. They feel it's the best doubles. They gather as few families. And it is a evil. It's another sex perversion. Some women will be continually praising other husbands. Some women will find every opportunity to belittle her husband. It's evil. They think it's very progressive. They are very broad-minded. Praising other man's, the husband of other women. That's very broad-minded. And belittling her husband in front of others. Very broad-minded. Nonsense. Idiotic. It's an idiocracy. It is another type of sex perversion. Another type of sex perversion. My dear brother, my dear sister. Here we see that word rioting means we must know our limits. Likewise, some men always want to ignore their wives in the presence of others when they go for parties. I always say many things from the Unnada part. One of the wonderful things in the Unnada part, in the banquet hall, when they go for a banquet, in the banquet hall, the banner over me is his love. That is another party. That's a song of songs. You go for a party. You take your wife for a party. All your relatives, friends are there. What should be the banner over the head of your wife? What should be the banner? Your love. It's not sidelining her. It's not a pride. It's not a pride. It's a lust for somebody else. You are sidelining your wife so that somebody else will look at you. I tell you openly, in the songs of Solomon we read, he took me to the banquet hall, you took your wife to the wedding party, you took your wife to a birthday party, you took your wife to a relatives program, you took your wife to a hotel. What is the banner over your head? Your love. I'm showing you from the Bible. He took me to a banquet hall and the banner over me is his love. That is the another part. My dear brother, my dear sister. So here it says, walk not in rioting and drunkenness. It is not only drinking excess of liquor. In one translation it says, to lose control, intoxicated. You lose your behavior when somebody else is around you. You have seen some children. When some guests come, they become excited. They lose their balance. They act cranky. This drunkenness, it's not just taking alcohol. You lose your behavior. Those who are drunken people, they smile without cause. They talk blah, 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 blah. They don't have a control over their talk. Similarly, when somebody sees some relatives or somebody, they get excited. They don't have control over their faculties. They lose control. So what is the weapon of life? Don't behave like that. Not in rioting, not in drunkenness. In simple word, if you want to have the weapon of life, be balanced. Be sober. That is the weapon of life. To save time, let me go quickly. 37. Walk not in chambering and wantonness. Congregation, I request you to bear with me. I'm just telling you the truth, the plain truth, what the Bible says. What does that word chambering? You know the word chamber? A room. You go to any good dictionary. What is chambering? Being in a room with an opposite sex, with a person of opposite sex in an illicit way. Whatever you may be doing, you are in a room, in a closed room, with an opposite sex person in an illicit way. Probably you are working in a company, that room is assigned for two people, you both are sharing the room. That is not chambering. You are in the same chamber. You are in the same chamber. The word is very powerful. I tell you a plain truth. A Christian cannot have chambering. You cannot be in one room. You cannot be under one roof with an opposite sex, with a person of opposite sex, without a proper reason. That is weapon of devil. That's the work of darkness. It's very, I mean, you can go and, suppose you are hurt. If you don't want to accept this, you take any other meaning, you please let me know. What does that word chambering mean? And maybe the translation in another version is more clear, being in bed vulgarly. Being in bed vulgarly. But chambering is not necessarily to be in bed. Whatever that age group may be, you are in a chamber, in a room, under one roof, without a proper reason, or in an illicit way. A Christian should not walk in chambering and wantonness. I want to know what the meaning of that wantonness, showing no thought. Showing, I think it's from Merriam-Webster's, showing no thought or care for the rights, feelings, or safety of others. We can't imagine a Christian in that situation. You are not worried about anybody else. You are not cared for the feelings of others. You are not cared whether others are hurt or not. You are not cared for others' rights. That is wantonness. In one translation for that wantonness, said having sex with many people. My dear brother, my dear sister. So in other words, what do we understand by this? What do we understand by this? We need not only a balanced behavior, we need a very strong moral strength, morality. We need a very strong moral strength. Like Joseph, you must be willing to run away. Willing to run away. You must be willing to change the channel. You must be willing to change the window. You can't be a coward. You can't be a slave to sin. What is the weapon of light? You must be able to uphold a high moral stand. That is the weapon of light. Let me go to 38. Walk not in strife and envy, quarreling, arguing, envying others, not happy with others' success. And number 39. Walk honestly. That word, not honest, literally, decently, decorously. Way that others could respect. As I said the other day, a kudigaran is not a father. Father is a father, kudigaran is a kudigar. A liar is not the father. Father is a father, liar is a liar. Father is a very lofty position. Father, one who cares for his children. Father, one who carries his children. Father, one who has got mercy on his children. Father is one who leads his children. That is the role of the father. A drunkard is not a father. A rogue is not a father. An adulterer is not a father. Father is a very high role. Father carries his children. Father leads, goes before his children. Father is a trendsetter. Father is a rolling model. Father, one who cares, one who carries. Father, one who chastises the children when they go wrong. That's the father. How can you call a drunkard the father? In Tamil, I don't know the real meaning. Pullu analum purushan. Pullu pullu thaan. Avan fulla irundhalum purushan solanuma. Pulla irundha kudigaran. If he's in adultery, he's an adulterer. The role of a husband, the role of wife, very sublime. So here it says, don't be quarreling, fighting, arguing, envying, and all. Walk honestly, in a decorous way, in a way that others could say it's right. And finally, it is the golden diamond on the crown. Finally, the weapon, the powerful, the most powerful weapon, put on the Lord Jesus. All the 39 points can be summed in this one point. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ. What do you mean by putting on the Lord Jesus Christ? Literally it says, and make not provision. That's not correct. You can make a change in the margin. So, make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof. In your body, you don't make any provision for the flesh. Your eyes, your eyelids, your eyebrows, your lips, your fingers, your neck, your hair, your dress, in your body. The body is the temple of God. In your body, head to toe, or I can say hair to toenail, you make no provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust of the soul, the lust inside. Don't use your body to fulfill the lusts of the flesh. No, make no provision for the flesh. When they see your lips, when they see your hairstyle, when they see how you dress, make no provision for the flesh. When you make no provision for the flesh in your body, you are putting on Jesus Christ. That is the greatest weapon. In your smile, in your anger, in your irritation, let your body reflect Jesus and Jesus alone. Put on the weapons of light. So today we saw 10 points and our list goes to 40 points. And for time being, I stop with this. So what is the putting on the weapons of light? Subject unto authorities is the weapon of light. Do that which is good, that's weapon of light. And render all dues. Don't be in due to anybody, that's weapon of light. Love your neighbor. That is, be close to somebody who is suffering. That's your weapon of light. And number 5, know the time and try to redeem the time. And 6, walk not in rioting and drunkenness. Be balanced. And walk not in chambering and wantonness. Be of high moral standard. And 38, walk not in strife and envy. Don't be quarreling and don't be silly. And 39, walk decently and decorously. And 40, the weapon of light, put on the Lord Jesus Christ. What is putting on the Lord Jesus Christ? Make no provision in flesh to fulfill your lust, to fulfill the lusts which are in the flesh. Don't make any provision, don't give any room, don't do anything that could fulfill the lust in you. You cannot put on Christ. Putting on Christ, giving no provision to the flesh and the lust thereof, God will surely bless you, and you are putting on the weapons of light, the armor of light. Shall we pray?